Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Totally Legit Gaming. Today, we are playing GemCraft, Chasing Shadows. Now, I have had multiple requests to play this game by multiple people, actually. But in difference from most requests I get, these were more like, how do you play this game? How do you succeed at this game? How do you do it? So this is going to be more of a tutorial series rather than a regular Let's Play. So let's just dive right in and I'll show you that I have been playing this game a lot! I'm wizard level 9,464 and I will probably be even more by the time you see this video. And I have discovered pretty much most of what is discoverable, but as you can see, I have many, many, many more levels to beat on the hardest difficulty. You see these lights? That's on what highest difficulty you've beaten them on. So I have multiple left to beat on the hardest. I have multiple vision fields, which are basically challenge levels to beat. And I have some levels that I haven't beaten at all yet. And yet I have bajillions of skills. So yeah. Also, my talisman is pretty much decked out. So yeah, I play this a lot. I know my way around this game, but I am actually by no means an expert. There are people who are way better than me at this game. But I'm going to teach you the basics of how to play the game, how to think in this game, and how to progress in the fastest way possible to get to my level. I mean, you don't have to get my level, but I'm going to teach you how to progress and how to not be frustrated at this game, because I know there's a lot of people who are. So we'll get back to the main menu and we shall remove this save game and start from the beginning. So this is what you'll see when you start this game for the very first time. And it is a tutorial level that will teach you the basics. I kind of tell you to pay attention to this when you're actually playing the game for the first time, but I will teach you the basics anyway, but you should pay attention to what is happening. So there we go. Now we're allowed to actually play. So this is what the interface looks like. And if you didn't know this before, but since you have been asking, I'm guessing you already know what GemCraft is. GemCraft is a tower defense game, which means you have a tower, quote unquote, in this case your orb of presence, to defend against multiple waves of enemies. And to do this you have different towers or turrets or whatever to defend it with. The difference between GemCraft and most, I shall not say all, tower defenses is it's incredibly deep and there are multiple ways to play it. I mean, as always, there is an optimal way to play, but there are better and worse ways to play. For instance, here we have grade 1 gems. This is what you start with. These were put here when the level began. This one I placed myself. What you can do with these is that you can duplicate them, or you can upgrade them, or you can combine them with gems. And this is what made GemCraft so fun, is that you can craft gems. But for now, I'm just going to upgrade this a couple of times. Upgrading means that it does more damage, gets more range, shoots faster, and has a powerful or more powerful secondary ability. However, when you upgrade, it has to re-socket. And all of this can be improved with skills later on, so we'll get to that later. I'm just going to teach you the basics right here. I'm not scared about these walking past and getting to my orb, because these gems will take care of them. So this first level is almost impossible to fail. I mean, you had to do something incredibly stupid to fail this level. There we go. We've beaten the first level. That's how hard that is. So when you beat a level, you get XP and basically some stats about the level, and this is what you gain permanently, which is a token for the field, which means that you can play another level. You can get, not always, get talisman fragments. I'll show you what those do later. These are the achievements you got. Each achievement gives you one skill point, so achievements are pretty nice. You get some shadow cores, which are used in conjunction with the talisman. I'll show you that later. And some story elements. The story is not forgettable, but it's pretty basic, but it's still interesting, so I'd like to pay attention to it. Do remember, however, that this game is like the fourth in the series, so if you're starting with this game, well, you're obviously missing a lot of the story. So now we are at the map, and as you can see here, compared to my advanced game, save game, this is all we have. I have two levels I can play. I can't even see the rest of the map. Gotta get a drink. So what you can do here is access your skills pane. Blah blah. Every time you level up, you get 7 skill points, which is nice. And if you don't spend your skill points on your skills, they're saved down here in unspent skill points. And every skill point gives you 7 initial mana. That means that you have, for each skill point, you have 7 more mana to spend before the match begins. This is less important in the early game and gets pretty much mandatory in the late game, but it does help to have some spare mana in the late game. You can also spend Shadow Cores to buy skill points, but as you can see, it costs 1,000 Shadow Cores per skill point. So that's expensive. But for now, we're not going to spend anything in skills. The Talisman is empty when you begin, and you can upgrade these with Shadow Cores. You shouldn't do that, really. I mean, don't spend your Shadow Cores unless you have a really good fragment you want to upgrade. This one gives us 3% extra damage to Reavers, which is the basic enemy type, so let's just put that in our Talisman, and boop, now we have 3% extra damage to Reavers. You can upgrade fragments, and you can destroy fragments. Destroying them means you get Shadow Cores for them. So that's basically it. That's how the Talisman works. Achievements. There's a lot of achievements in this game, so if you want to chase achievements, just look at what the locked achievements are, and you can sort them and filter them and whatever. There's a lot of achievements that you can find and unlock, and each achievement gives you 1 skill point. Journey notes is just the story, all the story elements you have unlocked so far, so you can go through them. Tutorial, well, it teaches you how to play the game, but that's what I'm gonna do, so you don't need to click that. Haha! Anyway, for the next one, we're gonna go to the next level. And this one teaches you how to build towers, but in all honesty, you don't actually have to build any towers on this level, because you already have 2, and the enemies can only come from here and here, which means they will pass both towers. So instead, I'm going to take this red gem here, and I'm going to build, or create, a blue gem. Now both of these do about the same damage. This one does higher base damage and lower max damage. This one does higher base damage and lower max damage. Or the other way around, lower minimum damage and higher max damage. They also have different secondary effects. This one has chain hit, which means that if you hit someone and there's another monster nearby, it will hit both of them. This one slows the targets. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pick this up, press G to combine gems and drop it on top of the red one. Ta-da! And get achievement bichromatic. Now we have a red-blue gem. What this means is that it gains 20% damage, but it loses 30% special power. So this is for when you want to do more damage, but you don't really care about the secondary effects. That's when you do this. However, with skills, you can increase both the damage gained and the specials gained. So later in the game, using bi or even trichromatic gems will be very beneficial. But for now, we're just going to use 2 bichromatic, so I'm going to press D for duplicate, and now I have 2 gems. I'm going to put 1 there, and 1 there. You only need to click, you don't actually have to drag. You just click in a trap or in a tower, and they will place it there. And then we start. And hopefully this will be enough to kill all the enemies. There we go. That's the first wave. And you can see, here's 17 Reavers, they all have 7 hit points each, and an armor of 4, which means you need to do 11 damage to kill it in one hit. But you need to do more than 4 to do any damage at all. You get mana for it, so each monster you kill of this wave will give you 25 mana. You gain XP for killing them as well. However, If the monster reaches your orb, as in it walks all the way up here, each of these reavers will be banished, as it says. That means it's going to cost you 50 mana from your mana pool, and the monster will return and walk in on the outside again. So that's how you lose. Enough monsters walk up to your orb and get banished, and eventually you're not going to have any mana and you lose. Oh, I increased the speed. I didn't mean to. So these cost 360 to upgrade, so I'm going to wait until these are dead, and then I'm going to upgrade this one. There. And then I'm going to upgrade this one. Come on! They're probably going to pass. Yep. So I'm going to lose. If you click a monster, you target it. Basically, that means your towers are now focusing that monster. That doesn't mean that the towers can shoot out of the range, though, so keep that in mind. This means I'm going to get three monsters walking into my orb, which means I'm going to lose 150 mana. So if I had 320 or 360, I could upgrade this gem, but that would mean I would go down to almost zero, and as these walk into my orb, I would have lost the game. So I'm just going to let these banish and upgrade on after they've banished. So that's 1, 2, 3. Okay. Now I'm safe. So I'm going to upgrade this. And hopefully this gem can take care of all of them. Fire's a little too slow. Basically, there are two ways to tell if your gems are too weak. If your gems can't kill a single monster before it walks past because it has too much health, then you need a more powerful gem. If your gems can't kill the enemies before they walk past, as in it can't fire fast enough, then you need more gems, just more of them. In this case, I am actually going to use a trick, because this is 720 to upgrade. Both of them are. So in order to get a grade 4 gem, I'm gonna have to have like 1440 mana, which is a lot. But if I pick this up, press G, and drop it on top of this one, I now have one grade 4 because I joined two grade 3 together, so they upgrade one level. Which is useful. On the other hand, now I only have one gem instead of two gems, but I feel confident this grade 4 can handle this. So we're gonna increase the speed. As you can see, it does not have any problems whatsoever to defeat these. He said, and almost they ran past. There we go. Do I have time to upgrade this? No, I don't. So there we go. That is level 2 completed. And we got some achievements, a talisman fragment, and a token. So back to the map.
But mana, what about endurance mode?
Yeah, we'll get to that later. Alright, so we just gained a level, which means we now have more skill points. We now have 20 skill points, thanks to achievements and leveling up. So now it might actually be wise to spend some on skills. Skills have a primary and a secondary effect for the most part. This one gives us 4% more mana per monster kill. However, if I level this up, you see there's a second thing showing up, which means 4% lower mana pool milestones. I'll get to that very later. And these increase every, I think, 3 levels? Yeah, I think it's every 3 levels that the secondary increase. So it's a good idea to stop when the secondary effect increases and then move on to another skill if you don't have enough skill points, because you can't just keep plopping in skill points. As you see, I have 20, which would mean I could increase this to level 20, but I can only get to 5 because it costs as much as the level. So if I increase this, it's gonna cost 5 instead of like 1. So I'm gonna leave that there, and probably gonna get some points into fusion. As I said, initial mana is not that important in the very, very early game, so not gonna care right now. And this one gives us bolt damage and damage to reavers, but right now it doesn't actually do anything for us, so I might as well leave it. We don't have bolt. So I'm gonna go to the next level, in which we will learn about poison and traps. And as it says, gems in traps deal much less damage, but have a much stronger special effect. And they're not kidding. This poison gem here, for instance, does 10 to 20 damage and 8 poison damage. However, if I place that in a trap, it now does 2 to 4 damage, but 14 poison damage. So it gained 6 poison damage and lost almost 80% damage, I think. I think it loses 80% damage and gains 80% of its passive. Depending on skills, of course. This is just base stats here. So the first wave has 8 hit points. Second has 9, 10, 11, or no, 12 actually, 13. Which means that a grade 1 that does 10 to 20 damage, theoretically, should be able to handle everything. But for sake of safety, we're gonna put the grade 2 here. And we're gonna put that there. 11% chance to deal 1.63 times the damage. That is pretty lame, actually. Not gonna use that until I have skills. I'm actually gonna recycle that one with X, so I get the mana back. And instead, thank you. Instead, I'm gonna build myself another green gem, and I'm gonna group these two together and duplicate that. That was all the mana I had. And put these in each of their traps, and then start! I hope this will be enough. Now, these only fire, as you can see, 0.89 shots per second, which means that it doesn't even fire once a second. That means if a lot of monsters are walking over this trap, some of them are not gonna get hit at all. Like here. See? That is why you can have multiple traps. Poison should kill that one. Yep. So that's why you can have multiple traps, so you ensure that all the monsters get hit. There are other ways to solve this in the late game. Basically, you can upgrade your trap skill, or you can have amplifiers that make the gems fire faster. But we'll get to that when we get to that, which is way in the future. Just trying to teach you the basics here. So this is fairly passive. Once these have passed, I'm gonna upgrade this one. He got hit, I'm gonna upgrade that, and I'm gonna... I can't upgrade that yet. Fine. Blap. 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 But as you can see, the gem itself doesn't do a lot of damage at all. It does like 10% of their HP or something like that, which is not a lot. Compared to this one, which does a lot, and probably one-shots every single one of them. I'm gonna upgrade that just for safety. So if anything gets past these poison traps, it's gonna get killed by this one. Now, the reason I have a bichromatic gem here is because it does 20% more damage. I don't really care about the passives on this gem in the tower. These, however, are meant to poison the monsters, not actually kill them outright. Even though they kinda do. I'm just gonna speed this ahead. And as you can see, some of them walk past because, well, the traps can't kill them fast enough. I'm gonna upgrade that, I'm gonna upgrade that. And then I am not... I can't afford that yet. Combining is 120. Now we'll combine them.
Yay, 5th grade gem.
So this does 155 poison damage. Just think about that for a second. The max health is 17. However, it also has 19 armor, which means you need to do more than 19 damage to actually hurt this thing. But poison doesn't care about armor. So if you have very armored monsters like giants and stuff, poison is amazing in the early game. So this kills them really quickly. However, don't be fooled into thinking that poison is the end-all be-all for the entire game. It really isn't. It is much more efficient to kill the monsters in one hit but we'll get to that again much later. There we go. Lots of achievements, some shadow cores, a talisman fragment, and two tokens. This one looks different, and I'll show you why. And we gained a level, so we can increase our skills. Now I'm going to upgrade this to the next level so that the secondary steps up to 8%. And I'm going to get this one up to 6%. Can't afford that. That's a shame. Still, this is just for building costs. And right now we're avoiding building as much as we can because buildings cost a lot of initial mana that are better spent on gems. Now, why does this look different? It's because this one holds a wizard tower. And a wizard tower will give you, well, varying amounts of things, but in this case it's going to give us a battle trait. The dangerous thing about wizard towers is that the wizard tower will kill you if all the waves run out before you have unlocked it. So not only do you have to defeat the waves that come in, you also have to open the wizard tower. And in this case, it means opening these locks. And these are easy. It's just hit with 40 tower shots to unlock, and hit with 30 tower shots to unlock. Easy peasy. So we just shoot these until they open. So I'm actually gonna build a tower here, and place this gem in it. So these two are going to be shooting the locks. But we're probably not gonna be able to kill all the monsters fast enough here. So they're gonna walk past, which means that these gems will fire at the monsters as they pass on by. So hopefully nothing will reach our orb. We'll see. I wonder, can I afford... No, I cannot afford to combine these because that's 116. So we'll place one there and one there. Now the mana leeching gem is great because every hit that leeches mana... Not a lot, but it leeches mana, which means we get more mana than we otherwise would have. Ideally, however, we would have these in traps in order to increase the secondary function. But remember, that also decreases the damage of the gem. But in this case, the mana leech, well, we just really want mana from it, so putting that in a trap is a brilliant idea. But we don't have traps on this level, so meh. And as you can see, these great ones are nowhere near powerful enough to actually kill these. So what we'll do instead is that we'll just group these up and make it second grader. Now all of these are gonna walk past, and hopefully these will kill them. Now purple gems reduces mana or armor level on the monsters, but these have like... Oh wait... They have armor level 12, so you need to do 12 damage in order to do any damage, and this gem does 14 to 27. So it does more than 12, but the great one... Yeah, probably didn't do enough, so that's why they didn't take much damage. So, armor-tearing gems may seem like a brilliant idea early on, but they are really lackluster. I would not recommend focusing on armor-tearing gems ever. It's just really more efficient to get more damage instead of trying to wear down their armor before you hit them. And as I said before, if you're facing enemies that have a lot of armor, just go with poison. Because poison ignores armor anyway. Alright, so we cannot afford to duplicate or upgrade this yet. So we'll let this wave run by and then we'll upgrade it. There we go, Wizard Tower is unlocked. So at this point we can just group these two up. And put that here, I guess. And now we'll upgrade that, so we have a grade 4. Come on. Faster. Now it's raining, and you may wonder if that's just a graphical effect, but no, it isn't actually. Rain increases damage by 20%. So that is very useful. So now all enemies are gonna take 20% more damage, as long as it's raining. There we go. I'm gonna need a shit ton of mana to increase that, so let's just speed this up for a bit. So after the next wave, we should be able to upgrade this. Legzo. Now we have a grade 5. And here's something strange. This is a different looking wave tile. These are swarmlings. And as you can see, these are 11 reavers at 25 hit points and 38 armor. That's a lot of armor. This is 69 swarmlings. These waves are huge in the early game, and they move incredibly fast. And they also have a respectable amount of armor, so these can be really dangerous. You have to be ready for these, and ideally you'll have multiple gems set up so that you can kill all the swarmlings before they run past, because that's the swarmling's idea. There's so many that they'll run past the towers before they can kill them. There are other ways of dealing with swarmlings in the late game, but early on you just need a lot of gems. So we'll run this on, and let's see, how much is that? That's 2,000 to duplicate. This is... let's get that to 4 and then duplicate it. Actually, no. Yeah, let's do that. And then we'll duplicate that, so let's move. Do I have enough? Probably not. I do. Okay, there we go. Here's the swarmlings. As you can see, there's a lot of them. So if you only have a few gems, you might not actually have time to kill all of them. But now I think we do. Or, well, they might actually get past here. Ugh. They can also let other bigger monsters past because, well, obviously. Whew, nice. Oh yeah, you gain XP if you don't get any banishments. So there's an increasing multiplier, basically, if the Orb of Presence is untouched. But what I'm gonna do now is gonna press W and build a wall. Insert Trump joke here. I'm gonna build that like so, which means that monsters can now not walk this way, so they must walk around here, giving this gem more time to shoot at them. Probably not gonna need it, but you know, better safe than sorry. And these are way too expensive to upgrade now, so I'm just gonna group these two up actually and put that there. There we go. And the last wave is swarming, so I'm gonna put my big gem down there and my armor gem up here. Can't afford to upgrade that, but can't afford to upgrade that. That was a bad timing. I shouldn't have done that now. Oh, little finish. Alright, here we go. So that's gonna kill a few, and the rest are gonna run down here and get killed by this. Hopefully. No, I might not be able to kill all of them, actually. And I'm gonna force them to run up here. So they have to run up around this. Gives them the gem a little more time to kill them. But this is not gonna be enough. So duplicate and put that there. Oh my goodness. Oh, that was enough. Okay, good.
We did it!
There we go. Alright, so now we have a fair few things. Story, talisman fragment, and a battle trait scroll. I'll show you what that does later. And two hex tiles. Hex tiles are parts of the map. So now we can suddenly choose where to go next. We either go north into E, or we go east into I. And you move the map around with W, A, S, and D, or click and drag. Now the whole idea here is that we need to get the mana leeching gem as fast as possible, because the mana leeching gem is actually a skill. There's a lot of skills here that we don't have yet, that we can get. And in order to get the mana leeching gem, which is up here and then down into B, it's in B5, but in order to get that, we need a freeze spell. And the freeze spell is in H, which is up here, in H4, I think. So we need to get up to H first. But there's also a skill in F here, that is down here, which is the trap spell, which is really useful. So we need to do F5 first to get that level. But I'll show you that in the next episode, because I think I've fried your brain long enough. In the next episode, we will go through finding skill tomes, how to unlock them, and also your general plan of attack. So I will see you in the next episode.
Toodles!